Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen from Washington. I'm your host, Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. Don't forget, visit us online at robertchristianshow.com. And, you know, the last guest that we had calling the show from Australia, I loved it. But I can't remember their website address off the top of my head, but it was Sasha and her partner on the radio in Australia. But we had them on. But the funny thing was, it just dawned on me what happened, because they were giving out their website address, which is fine. And come to find out, in Australia, the websites end with .au. But the way that they said it was absolutely hysterical. And I don't know what it is about the Australian accent. I love it. But trust me, to the Australians, I think that we in the U.S., that we sound just about as funny as that they do to us. So with all the funniness aside, this show today, folks, is going to be something else. And I do want to get your undivided attention on today's live show, because trust me, it is well worth it.
The Robert Christian Show, addressing issues that matter.
Let's start looking at a solution. It may be shocking to you.
And now, your host, Robert Christian.
And once again, thank you very, very much. Now let me readjust my audio levels. Okay, here I go. Folks, before I actually begin the first half of this interview today, and it is a two-part interview, you'll hear it all right now today, and this is one of those people that and a subject that you want to sit on the edge of your seat for and get ready to fall off. As I was going through some of the historical facts as to the Holocaust, it really made me very, very mad, very angry, knowing the damage for generations to come that one man could perpetrate on people that he didn't personally like. It sounds very familiar to all of us Americans these days, doesn't it? The Holocaust began January 1933 when Adolf Hitler came to power, and technically ended his reign on May the 8th, 1945, called V-Day. Over 1.1 million children died during that time. Young children were particularly targeted by Nazis and murdered during the Holocaust. And they posed a unique threat because they lived, if they had lived, they would have grown up to a parent of a new generation of, in quotation, Jews. X quote. Many children suffocated in the crowded cattle cars on the way to some of these camps. And it makes me very furious. To those who survived were immediately taken to the gas chambers. That's the start. The Nazis sent 10 to 15,000 gay men and gay women into concentration camps where they were forced to wear pink triangles. And all of this happened because of one man. Folks, the first hour of the show, like I said, it is going to seem like a complete downer and a complete disastrous subject. But in my 30-plus years of being in media, I have never, ever had a subject like this on tap for any show, ever. But at the end of the show, there is going to be a happy hook with a happy ending and a bright future. And I look at what happened personally, at what the events that led up to the Holocaust in itself, and then once that it was finally over, how the people's lives have so changed. And I don't believe that it is appropriate for anybody to look back in history and not learn a very significant lesson from it. It's all right to make a mistake, so they say, but it is not okay to make a mistake and not learn a freaking thing from it. All right, let me find our guest. Where is our guest? Here he is. Henry Roth, it is great to have you on.
Wow, good morning, Robert. How are you? And thank you very much for getting a translator and reaching down to Melbourne, Australia, in our opinion, the jewel in the crown of the Southern Hemisphere.
You know, I would so love to go to Australia. The two ladies, I tell you, they wanted me to go to Australia. And, you know, I've had two or three people over the years. And by the way, they've all wanted me to go to Australia. But you might remember or know the name Mike Goldman. Do you know who he is?
Yes, I think I do.
For those that are in the States, Mike Goldman, he is a television personality. He was on, he was one of the hosts or co-hosts for Big Brother Australia off the Gold Coast. We love that show. We absolutely loved it. Fantastic.
I watch it with two fingers. I watch it with
Henry.
And then I go in closer. You didn't watch that show last time, so a little bit.
You know,
it's very Aussie. Very Aussie, very out there. Very uncensored.
We love that show. And I mean,
Why?
Well, it was so different, but we're used to Big Brother UK. We enjoy watching that immensely. And then come to find out Australia had a Big Brother, so we started watching it. And so we would binge watch it. And but Mike Goldman, he back to Mike, he was one of the co-hosts for Big Brother AU, and we're going to soon have him on the Robert Christian Show. At least we're in talks with him now about it. So it's really weird because Australia, they're reaching back, and I have tried for a long time to reach out to Australia.
Well, we're reaching out together. I get hands across the water, brother. Handshake.
Absolutely.
We're going past Fiji. We're going to go over Hawaii, into Los Angeles, and zooming down to the gorgeous city of Seattle, Washington.
And on the other side, we're going to go over. Let's see. We can go over the Fiji Islands. That's got to be absolutely gorgeous. Over the Solomon Islands, which is down there.
Yes.
Yep.
Keep going.
Oh, gosh. I'm trying to say the Christmas Islands, but that's a little bit further away. Let me think. And then we're first going to make a stop in Perth over there.
Okay. You want to go to Perth first?
Yeah, we're going to go to Perth first.
You're an adventurous man.
And then we're going to fly over to Adelaide. Yes, Adelaide?
Adelaide, yes.
Yep.
The city of churches and boulevards and amazing coffee. Adelaide, you got to visit that.
See, I know my geography pretty good. Then we're going to go to the Gold Coast. They've got a really cool theme park there. I can't remember the name of it.
It's all American. Everything we have here is American franchise, my friend. Think about an American theme park, think Australia. All our TV shows, our food, but not our mentality.
Well, you know, one thing that I do remember about Australia is this, and folks that are in the States, you all will think it's funny, but the Aussies, Australians, they love Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Yeah, we love Kentucky Fried Chicken, Burger King, Wendy's, Pizza Hut. I've got a Burger King down the road, and I think that I'm actually supporting the whole of the American economy right now. So you know what? America, don't worry. You're doing fine with all your franchises around the world. We friggin' love you.
You know what? I love Australia, too. And I want to go. I want to go see the Sydney Opera House and all of that, but I want to go where it's a lot of fun and where people hang out and just enjoy themselves. All right, Henry.
Well, then you've got to leave the best for last, my friend, and that's where I live, in the amazing city of Melbourne, most cultural city. It's friggin' cold out today. It's a beautiful, crisp, sunny winter's morning. We're freezing our bazookas off, and we are just chill like you wouldn't believe. Bound by the river, we'll have a couple of margaritas or two, and then we'll tell a few tall tales and true.
You know, that would be absolutely delicious. I would love it. You know, spend the summers in opposite hemispheres. Like, spend the summer in Seattle, then when it's wintertime here, we fly down to Australia and it's still summer. That'd be great. That'd be a lot of fun.
Why not?
And
why not?
By the way, for those that really want to know the truth, in the southern hemisphere, toilets actually flush counterclockwise.
Stop staring it, bro. You know what?
I asked a friend of mine, a very dear friend of mine, a doctor actually, that lives down in Uruguay, and I'd asked him. I said, "Hey, listen, Simon, flush your toilet and go look at it. Go see which way that the water flushes." And I said, "I bet you it goes counterclockwise." And come to find out, it did. And so I was laughing. I thought that was hilarious. Okay, Henry, let's get into the meat of the matter, the subject matter of today's show, because there is, you and your family have gone through hell and back when it comes to your own family history. How has that shaped who that you are today?
Look, I have to say to you that everyone's history is obviously different. We're all different human beings. And I have to say that I was blessed by the fact that both my parents came out of the horrors, the absolute horrendous scientific annihilation of the people, and I'll get onto my opinions about other genocides, because we're not the only genocide, and it's important that I emphasize that. But if you're asking for me personally, and I remember as young as I can remember, my father and my mother sitting me down and saying, "We embrace everybody. We love every religion, every color." Back then, when I was, I'm now 58 today, it's my birthday, but literally 54 years ago, my parents sitting down and saying to me, "Sexuality, religion, color, when you see somebody that has friends, they don't need your support. Befriend the people that don't have friends, that need support. And never are we to hear you besmirch other people on any level." So I was brought up, Robert, in an extraordinarily positive, loving for the world scenario. I was really, really, really lucky. I cannot say that was the same for all my peers, though.
So with your family, I know that before the show, you said that your family is from Poland. Is that where your grandfather was from?
Yes. So, I'll split both sides to you. And recently, my mother, my sisters and myself went back to Krakow because, believe it or not, they found the family that saved my mother's family during the war. And there is actually a medal ceremony that comes from the institute in Israel called Yad Vashem. And Yad Vashem honors righteous of the nations, which is actually people that aren't Jewish, that specifically helped Jewish people during the war. So can you imagine? We met there. It was a massive ceremony, 500 people. I mean, it had the security of a state ceremony. There was tanks outside. There were machine guns. There was both the speakers of the Israeli and the Polish speakers of parliament were at that event. And we actually embraced the amazingness of that woman that saved our family. So on my mother's side, they were from Krakow, which was a much more progressive town. My grandfather actually was, they were the richest family in Krakow, basically. They had the first phone number that my mother remembers, the first car, the first fridge, believe it or not. It was an amazingly salubrious lifestyle. They worked extremely hard. And when I see pictures of my grandfather, he was wearing a bowler hat, which in those days was very much how British people used to dress. Now, don't forget, you and I are global citizens. But back then, it was very much Polish. So can you imagine, he was dressed up, in a bowler hat. He was importing furs from England before there were commercial flights from England to Poland. So that was that sort of family. On the other side, an extremely different environment was my father's, who came from a village called, well, it was actually a shtetl, which is a little enclave of Jewish people, forced almost to be together because already there was the beginnings of anti-Semitism many decades before. And that was a highly, and that was, that shtetl was a highly religious shtetl, and he came from a line of rabbis. However, I want to put a little anecdote there. At the time when my grandmother married my grandfather, who I never met most of my relatives because they were annihilated, massacred, exterminated in the war, there is a tradition for Jewish women, religious Jewish women, to have a shaitel, which is they shave off their hair and they put on a wig, you know, to ward off other men looking at them. So the tradition goes. So can you imagine, and I love my grandmother for that, she basically said, you marry me with my hair or you don't marry me at all. So she was a renegade, and I feel I had that renegade in me. So she married my grandfather. So two very different families, but very near from each other and actually close by to Auschwitz. Very close.
I am still, in my mind, Henry, extremely appalled by what had happened back in the day. And, you know, how that so many people these days are not willing to look back at history and learn the valuable lessons that, and they're missing this.
Well, but, you know, I think, Robert, sometimes... and I understand your passion. You're a very passionate man. We've had wonderful conversations off camera. I've even met your dog Biscuit, who I absolutely adore. And you're a man of progress, and you like to embrace a lot of things. I would say this: I think sometimes to be punitive about it and to admonish people, I'm not saying you in particular, I'm saying me, I don't really think gets a message across. I think one has to act by example. And I also think, and I'm going to be very honest with you, the actual fact, it's important to embrace all cultures. And that's kind of what I do. I try and say, look, you know, it's yes, it was a horrific genocide. And I'm going to actually paint two stories for you in a moment that I actually literally learnt about my parents 3 weeks ago. That's how much they've been holding stories together. And I'm going to tell you, you know, because when I personalize these stories, these two stories alone will be enough for you to understand the horror of what went down. And I will brace ourselves for that because it's hard going. But I just want to say that from my perspective, I believe I am a global citizen of this planet. I'm Polish, Jewish, gay, Australian. I'm not sure if there's anything left additional with that. And I have Muslim friends, Polish friends, German friends, Jewish friends.
Yes.
I don't judge people by their culture. I judge people by the culture of their soul and their heart. And so if we start thinking about, because a lot of people are not in touch with this. So I try and make it current. I talk about the killing fields of Cambodia. I talk about the atrocities that are happening in North Korea here and now.
Yes.
And if I was brought onto this world, Robert, to do anything, it was basically to shine a light on the fact that we have to embrace love. We cannot embrace hatred. So that, you know, I understand your anger and your, you know, but I've just learned that if I am punitive about it, it doesn't help the cause of people understanding love.
Well, I think that as we look at history, they've said that history has a tendency to repeat itself, and I think perhaps that it does, but the lessons, though, that we have learned from the past and from our individual past, much less the past atrocities around the world, that we can all learn something from them and be able to move ahead and not do those anymore.
Yes, exactly. I mean, the fact that you're speaking to me, that you have this amazing show that's on Syndicate, that you have an open mind, that you are sharing this with other people. We don't all have to agree. Some people have thought that that was a good thing, that Jewish people were exterminated. I'm not here to teach people how to think. I'm here to share my time with people I want to share my time with. A little small thing the other day, you know, with business, basically this person was bringing me around and I just called them up. I said, listen, this is not for me. Good luck. Bye. Yes. I don't need to send them a missile. I don't need to send them vitriol. I don't need to do hate mail via Facebook. I don't need to do that. So I think that by acting like by example, some people don't like Jews. That's just how it's going to be. Some people don't like Muslims. Some people don't like gays. Some people don't like lesbians. Some people don't like transgenders. Some people don't. Good luck to them. Leave me alone. I don't have to convert you. Well, I don't have to love you either. Don't have to love you, but yes. I don't have to be an asshole about it. Excuse my English. I don't have to be. It's about mutual respect, Robert.
Well, you know what? Just by the boxes that you laid out there, the gay people, that's a box. The Muslims, that's a box. The Chinese people, that, well, okay, you didn't say that, but okay, that's a box. But you know what? I've got people that either love me or hate me in this life. They hate me because I'm in their face. I tell it the way that it is. I challenge them. I challenge their motivations. But I've got other people that love me to bits. And, look, I'm just me. And Henry, you're just you. But when you look at your family heritage, your family history, as being a part of one of the worst disasters.
Yes.
Yes. Globally, even to this date. I mean, it's mind-boggling, Henry.
Well, first of all, I love the fact that people love or hate you. You know, I've done a lot of reality TV in my time. I've actually been the mentor on Project Runway Australia. I've done a lot of TV in Australia, in America, and we'll get to that later on. And they always used to say to me, let them love you or let them hate you, but don't let them like you. It's, so you know what? You're not vanilla, my friend. And so that's number one. Yes. Number two, when we talk about shaping history, look, there's no doubt about it. I feel I carry a burden as far as I was at the age where I only came out to my parents at the age of 35. Why? Because, you know, at some point I was really fearful. I was, imagine that background. And there was, like, say, for example, on my grandmother's side, there were 19 brothers and sisters, approximately. Wow. Stepbrother, I think 3 survived. Right? On my father's side, everybody was annihilated. So the bottom line is, I was supposed to carry the name. So obviously, when I came out at the age of 35, I didn't carry the name. So for me, as I've got older, the older I have got, the more I've come to terms with the fact that I need to do something, I need to have a platform. I don't even think my family understands to the extent of that. And I'll come to that later on. But I agree with you, and I'm going to actually now paint you 2 horrific scenes to explain to you why my fire burns, but at the same time, why I can't continue the hate. Because you see, if I was to continue the hate, then it's going to just not break the cycle. So brace yourself. If I get a little bit choked up, you're going to have to excuse me, and I'm going to have to just take it slowly because it's pretty horrendous. I'll do the first one, which was my father, which you listened into his interview with Sasha and Sonia. And by the way, I will give you their website address at the end of this. They're dear friends of mine.
And that's the conduit.
You'd think there was about 5 people in Australia. You all know, everybody there needs to know Robert right now, but in Australia. But they're gorgeous women. And you heard this interview. And so basically, I went along the lines that when Poland was divided between the German side and the Russian side, they didn't know who was going to be the worst enemy. And so they decided that my father's side was going to stay on the German side, and they were going to, because they had to hold on to the property, and they elected that my father and my grandmother was going to escape onto the Russian side.
Mm.
Along the way, they were still in the German side, and they were running away. And by the way, when they were crossing rivers, you know, there were people in boats, and they were shooting, you know, holes into the boats and watching them drown. And I think the thing that my father said that I never knew was that, and I don't call them Germans, they're Nazis. And there's good people and bad people, by the way. And some of my best friends are German people, and I love them like my brothers and sisters, by the way. So basically, they would laugh at them while they were killing them. And they were, you know, it was a sport. And I never knew that. Mm. There's a lot of things I didn't know. The second thing I didn't know was, so my father's conveying this one story. They were starving. So they get to this farm or something, and there was a boy, they were both age 12. And my father said, listen, there's a bakery down the road. You and I, let's go and let's take some bread from the bakery. They were starving to death. I can speak German because in my household, my father said to the little boy, German and Yiddish. I will distract the German soldier. You go in and collect the bread. So basically what happened was, his friend went to collect the bread. The German soldier who was asleep got startled and he saw his friend and he stopped him. And basically he said to me, to the little boy, you're stealing from the German army. The little 12-year-old boy, you're stealing from the German army. That's not right. Then he said, I'll forgive you, the soldier said. But stand up here on the platform, I'm going to show you something. Have a look at the barrel of this gun. There'll be a little bird coming out of the barrel of this gun. And of course he put his finger in the barrel and he shot his head off in front of my father. It's the cruelty. It was the systematic cruelty of that I just can't. Anyway, so I'm only conveying these stories because this is a horror that any nation, any people, any religion has suffered the ridicule. On my mother's side, they were doing a thing called an axia, which was actually a liquidation, the final liquidation of a ghetto. Everyone was lined up. They were put in squares and they were basically carted off, you know, in cattle tucks. They couldn't even stand. I always keep thinking they could hardly even breathe. But the thing that I think that gets me is the toilet. I don't know why, you know, there's different elements of human elements. Like, can you imagine? Anyway. And for hours and hours in the heat or in the cold, no food, no water, anyway. And my mother said that two things. She'll never forget the scream. So she was hidden in a loft. And she said that loft was overlooking the square. And she will never, ever forget the screams, the hurling cries of pity. Please save me. As they were being shot and murdered. And while this was happening, there were apparently some German soldiers. And those German soldiers, can you hear me, Robert? Okay, sorry.
Yep.
It was just went out for a moment. Sorry.
No.
And those German soldiers basically said, they came past. And of course, they couldn't have any sound. And there were two babies there. Just give me a second. And so they had to get a pillow to hush the sounds of the babies.
Mm.
They didn't make it. They had to kill them in front of my mother. That's a really tough one. So that's why, how can I hate people? And they can't hate people. And that's why any time you say something that's harmful to somebody, if you don't like somebody, as my father says, you don't have to say anything. So I suppose I do carry that history, and I'm proud to carry that history. And I think the biggest things for me are yet to happen. Sorry, I'm going to... it's not easy when you get glasses, is it? Not easy, but I think that's why I can't tolerate jokes about gay people that are nasty. I can't tolerate any of it. It's like somebody scratching on the wall. And I'm proud of the fact that that's where I've come from. You don't have to love me. But there's a fantastic quote by Pink, and I adore her, by the way. You don't have to like me. No, you don't have to love me. You don't have to like me. But you have to respect me.
Yes. You know, Henry, I look at what... you've said so far, and I am not even amused. I'm very saddened by it. But I can say this, friend to friend with you, though, and I'll be honored to call you a friend.
We made friends the minute I met you and Biscuit in the car.
But Biscuit the dog. But Henry, I have heard so far what you have said, and your mindset is one that an overcomer and an achiever would have, not a victim. And although your mother, your father, your grandparents were victims of the most heinous incident in world history, perpetrated by one man, but your mindset is not one of a victim, but of a victor.
Do you know what? That's such an interesting point. And can I give you the honor of telling you, I've never ever had somebody point that out. And, you know, that's why it's interesting. You know, you meet somebody, and we met through extraneous circumstances because, of course,
we had
a little bit of a go of our technology here in Australia, and you're like, geez, we think it's bad in America. Go live in Australia and try and communicate. But we've met through incredible circumstances. There's people you meet in your life that instantly there's a bond, and I can feel this whooshing through as we speak. And that's why the connection's so strong, and that's why I have to commend you, that I've never, ever had that posed either to my family or my friends or myself. And I have to tell you, and I'm really searching deep in my soul, never considered victim, and never even my parents considered themselves victims. In fact, the name, because I'll tell you what happens. When you're subjected to that kind of cruelty and, you know, you're facing death every day for years, I think you take your mind to the next level and you almost disconnect. You don't have the luxury to think of yourself as a victim or not a victim. I think today, to be very honest with you, in my experience of world events and current affairs, and by the way, on my gorgeous little, you know, iPhone here, American technology, yay. I have to say, you know, I've got on my apps, I've got, you know, what do I have? Los Angeles Times, New York Times, The Guardian, Deutsche Welle. I don't think that the word victim somehow is used anymore. I think people, and so it's easy to say, yes, they were victims. I think the thing is, they were incredibly lucky to escape the horrendousness of that war, but even more so, and this is where I haven't even got the answer for you, Robert, on this one. How in bazookas, because that's a bit of a West Coast term, a Seattle West Coast term, how in bazookas did they ever embrace trust in people? Like, if it was me, mate, I would just be the most horrendous human being left on the planet. I would just trust nobody, and I would just be snarling the whole time. I'll be honest with you. But my parents aren't like that. So I think the thing is, no, I don't consider them to be victims. I don't, and I don't consider myself certainly not to be a victim. And on top of that, I consider them to be able to embrace life. And in actual fact, my mother has finally, so what happened was, my mother decided she was going to write a book because first of all, for 70 years, she didn't speak a word about it. And then she came to circumstances where the war almost threatened her never to be able to speak. Then she was in ICU, and she was one of the longest surviving and survived incubation for a woman her age, 11 days without sedation. And when she came out of that, she thought, right, I am going to speak. And so she wrote her book, The Right Time to Speak. And throughout the book, and I've read about 3/4 of it, the first part kept me awake for 4 days because there was all these stories I didn't know. Never was there the mention of victim. And I think the thing is that's becoming a term that less people use. And I think in its place, it's like how we overcome the challenges of life. And I know that sounds like a euphemism, but that's what I think.
Ladies and gentlemen, our guest, Henry Roth, his mother, his father, and bless them, I will use the term, they are victims of what had happened during the horrible regime of Adolf Hitler and the Holocaust. And, you know, Henry, to me, it is an absolute historic milestone in my career, being in communications for as long as that I have, to have somebody like you that I'm talking to. Absolutely magnificent, top-notch. Because I listen to your heart. You know, there's a lot of things, Henry, that people say that words cannot. If it is not body language, it is facial expression. It is, yes, listening to one's heart, listening to where they are, and Henry, knowing the atrocity that your family suffered by the hand of one man. That's what makes me very mad. It makes me very angry. I mean, who gives him the right? But he perpetrated those rights upon himself, and he perpetrated the crimes against humanity upon everyone that he possibly could. And Henry, it is you, it is your family that were able to escape that literal bondage. Let's talk about that a few minutes.
Look, I have to say to you an interesting point, and obviously it's interesting, you know, a good interview, you don't feel like you've been interviewed, and I feel like I'm sitting here with you, and I feel like we're in a coffee shop somewhere in the gorgeous city of Melbourne, which you, by the way, the Dreamliner that you guys make in Seattle, Washington, went millions of people all over the world, and some of the Dreamliners come down to Australia. And now we've got a direct service, my friend, via Los Angeles, and I have got no shares in any airline. But let me tell you, the day will come when I'll be greeting you and Biscuit at the airport. But I feel like I'm sitting next to you, opposite you, as the sun is rising here in the gorgeous city of Melbourne. And maybe towards the end of this, I'll have the guts to take my camcorder and just so it doesn't get cut off, because you know what the communication is like.
Yes.
But I feel, first of all, an incredible bond here. And you talk about something that I've not thought about myself. So it takes somebody with more than 37 years of mile to mile or kilometer to kilometer, you know your stuff. And that's the difference, by my friend. They can have as many bots as they want, and they can have as much automatic intelligence as they might like in any accent that they want. But when it comes down to quality and humanity, not yet, my friend, have they made a clone of you. So that's number one.
No, they haven't, but they sure have made a lot of clones of the Dreamliners, haven't they?
Well, but we don't mind about that, because that's machines taking it to human beings. Machines to human beings, not machines to machines, my brother. So, and along those lines, that, you know, and by the way, I do lighten up my conversation when we talk about this topic, not because I'm a comedian, but because I feel that we have to at points, you know, get people to get off the floor and not have a heart attack from this topic. But the truth of the matter is that Hitler personifies to me the ultimate bully. You see, there's no difference. What gives, for goddamn right, any kid, any human being, any person to single out other kids and bully them?
Yes.
It's all about bullying. So that's the thing. When I speak to kids at schools, by the way, Sasha and Sonia talk to kids at schools. We've talked about this topic a lot. These are, by the way, guys who are just joining us, dear friends of mine in Melbourne, who are experts at their field when it comes to teenage whisperers, I call them. And the bottom line is this: ultimately, it can ultimately end as a Hitler. Any bully that thinks they have the God-given right, because there's no, we believe in God, fight, or whatever right they think they have, or any license that they think they have, show me the piece of paper that says you can F up another person's life. You can destroy another person's life because you don't like them. You don't like the color of their hair, their sexuality, the religion. There's no such license. And when you ask me what is the message to my family was, and from my father, If you see somebody at school that needs a helping hand, they're the ones that you need to be friends. The other ones that are popular, they don't need more friends. And that's our responsibility. And if this conversation touches people's hearts, and by the way, I'm no saint, I've done a lot of wrong things in my life. I effed up something badly the other day with the situation. I feel really badly, and I've got to bring a bunch of flowers to this woman who I think I insulted, and it wasn't meaning. I didn't mean to, and I've had sleepless nights about it because she's really dear to me. But acknowledge it, and say, listen, I really, really, really effed up, and I apologize. But that's the difference between a person that's a bully and thinks that what they do is right.
Yeah. Oh, Hitler absolutely.
Hitler was the ultimate bully. I mean, don't you think?
Absolutely. And you know, American politics, I don't know, Henry, how much that you pay attention to American politics, but
everything happened, every bloody bit of it.
A lot of Americans, a lot of people they look at Donald Trump as a cutout copy of Adolf Hitler. A brutal dictator, and I can see the similarities, absolutely. But I want to focus, like I said, Henry, on you, because this is your life. This is your story. I mean, I could get into politics and talk about it, and I do. But when it comes to your story, your survival, your family's survival, escaping the atrocity that was imposed upon you and upon your family, and then of course in the next hour, folks, don't forget the next hour. And I'm telling you, because we are going to completely flip this on its ear. Because Henry, if I can make those sound effects, Henry, he's going to be talking about his life beyond the Holocaust and his parents' life beyond that. And I'm not going to give it away just yet as to what Henry does, but we're going to get into that in the next hour. So there is your sign. There is your hook. Think about that for a few more minutes. Anyway, Henry.
You know, Robert, you say that, you know, you're concerned that it's my experience, and it is my experience. And the way I've carried, and by the way, just a sidebar comment on the politics of America at the moment, this is how I look at it. America, I've lived in New York City for 15 years. I have lived in New York City.
Yeah.
I think America personally, and I take it generally, is an amazing country. But leaving politics for a moment, it's extraordinary. It's been the cradle of the Dreamliner. It's been the cradle of so many amazing things. And you know what? Everything has an ebb and flow. Some people think the situation is good. Some people think the situation is bad. But everything goes and comes in roundabouts. And if the current scenario is making the world, because listen, you think you're impacted? We're all equally impacted. The world is one big globe. Believe me, my brother, we're all feeling it. Everybody's feeling the ground zero, and it has the epicenter. And the bottom line is we're all living it together. And we only know one thing over here. A better day will come.
Yes.
Because that's how we feel. So that's number one.
Well, number two, Henry, and I will put this, you know, there are people who think...
Let's go.
There are people who believe that the earth is flat. But in a roundabout way, their idea is, or my idea is, if the world was flat, then a cat would have moved everything from the earth. Just slap it around a little bit, and where it lands, who knows? That's right.
And you've got to keep smiling, because sometimes things get really serious. But going right back, because people say I digress, and I had no idea why they would say that, young man. But they say I digress. But the point is, I do take the experience of the Holocaust personally, and so therefore, the only way for me, my children, the children I've never had, because I don't think I would have had children anyway if I would have had a partner to have children with, but I didn't have children. So my children is my responsibility to send out the global message that I have. And that's why this opportunity with you, you have no idea how exciting it was for me, because here I knew I was going to get up at bloody 5 o'clock in the morning, shave, make sure I put the actual moisturizer on, put a little bit of stuff on my cheeks, so, you know, all the like blemishes, make sure I have my coffee ready. But it was the opportunity to speak to somebody that was highly intelligent, that was sharp as a tack, that would bring out in me things I haven't thought about. But I do take it personally. My family do take it personally. But we are also living in the world, and we are living in a community. From as young as I remember, why I'm an Americophile, is there such an Americophile, and why I actually love America so much, and Seattle, my uncle used to have business in Seattle.
Wow.
So when you called me and you said, let's do an interview, and I'm a syndicated service going all around America from Seattle, Washington, he had an interest in Seattle at the time, which had the name Melbourne attached to it. You're calling me on my birthday is like my grandmother upstairs is like playing puppets with us. That is the beauty of life. And the beauty of life is that I have the global perspective. My world, my personal experience is my globe. And that's how I see it. I really do.
Henry, you said that once before, as I remember, about you feeling that your grandmother was playing puppets. When I contacted you. But you know what? I'm thrilled that I did. And it was Sasha and her partner from Australia that said, hey, you need to get Henry on and your parents and talk about their experiences and talk about their life. But, you know, I want to, like I say, in the next hour, Henry, to put a decent and nice little hook on the end of the interview, the conversation with you, because you know what in history was bad, we as human beings we can't change history, but we can refuse to repeat it. We can learn the lessons from it, and say no, I'm not going to jump off that cliff again. Let's go this other way. There has to be a better way. And Henry, you have found it, because like I said, you're not portraying a victim of what had happened to your family. And you could, of anybody that rightfully could, you could, but you're playing out that you are a victor. And you have stood the test of time, and I wish that people would hear that story.
Well, the hook that could be a possibility, because, you know, you and I are co-producing right now, is my last name actually is not Weinreich. Sorry, my last name is not actually Roth. That, Robert, as I've shared with you before, is my sister's married name. And as we hook into the next hour, I recall specifically calling my parents, and we'll get to the reason why I made that call. Don't forget, not only was I not having grandchildren for them, but now I'm calling them up and saying, look, would you mind if in America I'm known as, instead of Henry Weinreich, they'd call me Henry Roth? And my parents put down the phone and they said, yes, fine. And I could tell my mother was a little bit strange about it. Years later, my mother said in her Polish Jewish accent, I thought you completely lost it. So how did I become from Henry Weinreich to Henry Roth is an American dream come true, to be honest.
Well, folks that really want to know, Henry Roth, I'm going to use Henry Roth. For those that want to know, Henry, he is well-known when it comes to the world of fashion design. I'm not going to tell you what yet. We'll get into it. Maybe sweet talk Henry, and maybe he'll tell you. He has made a name for himself and a name for his family. What on earth happened there?
I was about to go straight. I was doing this, and then I swiped off the mat from my desk. You know, at school, I was 3/4 of my life. I spent very expensive schooling, by the way, in the corner. So the fact that I am sitting through a 2-hour interview is actually, my parents want to know how you actually have achieved that. But that's, I was trying to do strong arm me, you see?
You know, I've had some really weird, bizarre things happen on the air before, but never that.
Oh, mate, I've had some friggin' awesome things happen to me on air.
But, you know, folks, so like I say, and before I was interrupted by a sword, but Henry, there is a lot to him that I want him to get into and feel comfortable with talking about. But his family and their history, their story, to me, it is one of those stories that must be heard, because Henry, unless the story is heard, how can anybody hear it?
Well, I agree with you. And so, you know, look, there are a lot of, not a lot, but there are a significant amount of books that are written about the Holocaust. As I said, my mother is about to launch in Sydney, and then it's going to go national and international, The Right Time to Speak. Am I allowed to quote a website, if I may?
Yep, sure, go.
So it's obviously, we've just put it up, it's called therighttimetospeak.com. And I look at how do we make sure that those memories, that respect, and that history is contained and continued and perpetrated, because there's a lot of Holocaust denial. Now, when there's Holocaust denial, people get extremely emotional and understandable. I just use facts. The only way to combat such horrendousness, to actually now reverse it and say that we made it up. You know, there's this whole Jewish conspiracy thing, right?
Yeah.
So the whole Jewish conspiracy thing is, so I tell you, here's my best. So with the Jewish conspiracy thing, which goes back to there was no Holocaust and that we run the world. Now, I had lunch with somebody a few days ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, and they're sitting down with me and they was talking about, we were just talking, they said, you know, they own the world. I'm like, who? Who owns the world? They go, you know, the Jews. I said, really? And he didn't know I was Jewish. And by the way, I only come across love, because I only put out love and I only get love back. I have never had once in my life anything except positivity, I'll be honest with you. I've got no complaints to anyone on this planet. So, but he was talking to me going, you know, the Jews. I said, what? What are they? Well, you know, Rothschild and everything. I'm like, what about Rothschild and everything? He said, you know, they, you know, and it's all connected to that the Holocaust didn't exist and all that sort of stuff. I'm saying, well, how much do they own? Everything. I said, you know what? Can you do me a favor? I'm pissed off. He goes, why? Why? What's wrong? I said, look, I'm Jewish. And when next time you see a Rothschild, will you give them my phone number and say they owe me $3 million? Where's my bloody money? I'm the only poor Jew in town. You know, what, you've got to make light of it.
But Henry, speaking of money, let's talk about money a minute, because
let's do it.
I've never asked anybody about it, so let me ask you. I want to get, I guess, up close with this one, because I don't know, and, you know, if you don't know, you want to ask the question, right? So did the government of Germany and or the government of Poland, did they give your family some sort of financial compensation due to what had happened during those years during the Holocaust?
Okay, well, first of all, definitely there were reparations. And the German government, there was a long period of time, I think it might have expired, initially helped the state of Israel a lot.
Yes.
In cars. And the ironic thing was, Mercedes-Benz was a symbol of Holocaust atrocities. And then, so Jewish people outside of Israel never, like, they would be boycotting anything to do with, like, Mercedes-Benz, anything that was a Nazi symbol. But then you go to Israel and there were all these Mercedes-Benzes everywhere, which was a different story. So to cut a long story short, yes. First of all, the state of Israel was absolutely helped, and that was amazing. Second of all, no doubt about it, the German government and the Israeli government have got a lot of economic ties together, and the people have a lot of economic ties together. A lot of German people go to Israel on kibbutzim, so it's not just money, it's also a cultural exchange. So that's on that side. And then Holocaust people generally, there was a reparation board, if you like, for people individually, a pension. Some people got a big pension, some people got a small pension. My parents only applied recently because they had, they didn't want to. They really didn't want to. It's a tiny amount that they get every month. But the bottom line is, it's still symbolic. So to cut a long story short, you know, money can't buy, but it definitely helped. And I think overall, to be very honest with you, we are the new generation. So I'll give you a perfect example. Look, the older generation, a lot of Jews, you know, because you talk about money compensation, but then also there's a healing, okay? So I'll give you two examples for me. You're talking about my own personal, you know, you're trying to get to my own personal experiences. I'll give you two, one Polish, one German. So the Polish one is that, you know, in the current state of affairs, there's still people, my parents alive, most of them would not go back to Poland, Robert, because it's a graveyard. My mother, as I told you, went back to Poland. She's embraced hate. She has made, she loves that country. That's the country of her birth. Some Jews don't understand that. But also she found, as I told you, the family that saved them during the war. And my mother taught us to love that family. And we love that family. Moving forward, generations, that were years later, in a certain circumstances, there was this, we'll get to my future. There was this Polish bride. She didn't have very much money. She came down to our showroom and in New York City. And we made a point, not only of her having the most beautiful dress, but we only charged her what she could afford, which was not even anywhere near our cost. Why? We were determined. It wasn't even something that we spoke about, my sister and I. It's because we want, because the cycle of hatred has to be stopped. Similarly, as I told you, I had some of my best friend, probably my best friend, my soul BFF. She calls me Charlotte. I call her Fifi. And best friends. Why? Because we have to break not just the money side, but the cultural side has also been broken.
You know, Henry, I have learned a tremendous amount from you and from your testimony and your wisdom. And I am very sorry that your family suffered the way that they did. That was so wrong. Wrong for any generation. But I want to, in the next hour, Henry, if you'll hang on with me, if you don't give up on me yet. But
never,
I want to talk about more or less your family's escape out of hell and focus on you and what you've done, how that your life has gone on, and what you're doing now, because you have a fantastic and a magnificent challenge that you've laid out, I think, for yourself, and you've overcome a lot of obstacles to achieve that.
No problem, Robert. I will stick with you to the ends of the earth, my friend.
All right, hang on, Henry, if you will. Ladies and gentlemen, our friend Henry Roth, he is one amazing man that has quite a bit that he wants to share. And we're going to be giving him that platform to be able to do that. This is the Robert Christian Show. Visit us, of course, on the web at robertchristianshow.com. I would say .com.au. That's how they said that. How Sasha said that. It had a hook to it. .au. Anyway, folks, hey, a lot of stuff, of course, going on the show. And we do want to encourage you to help to support the show. We use PayPal, if you'd like to know. We use PayPal. But anyway, we hope that you will at least give this show a chance to make your day. And our guest today, Henry Roth, to give you a bit of a history lesson on really what happened. Because, you know, we can look at what happened back in the day, like I said, folks, during one of the most darkest hours in world history. But unless we learn something from those days, and we walk away with something, a lesson learned, we're destined then to repeat it. And that is just so not right. All right, folks. Hey, this is Robert Christian bidding you farewell. If you guys are taking off for the day, hey, don't go away. Well, you can, I guess, if you must. Yes, nonetheless. Love you. Love everybody. We have to love everybody. And I am going to, let me see, where is my settings? Here we go. We are going to switch gears here, ladies and gentlemen, so don't go too far. In the meantime, Robert Christian bidding you farewell, and we will catch you on the flip side.
Yeah, no problem.
And good day, mates. For those of you that are in North America, this is the Robert Christian Show. We are live every Friday at 3 p.m. Pacific, 3 to 5 p.m. And we are thrilled to have you all tuned in on today's live show. I tell you what, I am thrilled beyond measure that we have the guest that we have today, because he is an inspiration. And his message is definitely one of love, one of hope, one of joy. And we want him to be able to have a platform to share his good tidings with you. And when we come back, this is the second half of the show, but when we come back, we're going to be talking again with Henry Roth, and we're going to find out a bit more about him, from stitches to the seam. Not figuratively speaking either. Stay tuned.
The Robert Christian Show, addressing issues that matter.
Let's start looking at a solution. It may be shocking to you.
And now, your host, Robert Christian.
And thank you very, very much. I do know my name, by the way. Let me see. Where is my... I have to look for my settings. That way, our guest today can actually hear everything, then hola, that is being said. Okay, now I get to find him this way. Where? Oh, there he is. Hey, Henry. Let me see what on earth happened. Oh, duh. Okay, I am back, Henry.
Yes, did you ever leave me? That was the question.
Yeah, you know what? I did for about a whole 10 seconds.
I managed.
You know, I don't know. So I've done a lot of interviews, Henry, and people have told me, oh, God, the interview is an hour long. Oh, no, what am I going to do? You know, start slapping the forehead. And I explained to them that once you get going in an interview and you start talking, asking questions and rehearsing and remembering and, you know, just side talk, 1 hour is nothing.
Well, Robert, for those of you that haven't been interviewed by you or have had the honor or privilege or excitement of being interviewed by you, I would liken it to being on a psychiatric chair and spilling the beans. It's very cathartic. I feel like I can call up my shrink now and say, you know, bro, I don't need to come back to you for the next 6 months. And it's also interesting because, you know, talking about rehearsal as such, you know, and the reality TV that I've done, the best that I've done, we had the Mivens, if you like, from Project Runway Australia, and we'll get to that later on. And the very best seasons we had was when it was run by Americans here in Australia, or, you know, the mainstay, and we had a floor manager. And the way he operated was this. While the cameras weren't on, you weren't talking. And I went up to him afterwards, right at the end of the season. I said, why? He goes, listen, buddy, it's like this. If you're speaking, that means you're saying already what's in your heart. It'll never be the same. It's like rehearsing. And you understand that more than anybody. We've not rehearsed any of this. This is as it comes from the heart to the mouth, from the mind to the body. And that's why it's so, shall we say, amazingly sizzling and highly cathartic. You know, I feel like I'm a new man.
I love it that way, Henry, because I've had guests, and it really irritates me. Well, sort of, kind of. But when they say, okay, well, do you have a list of questions that you want to ask? I'm like, yeah, sure, I can come up with a list of 100 questions, easy, right? But in the course of an hour, you might be lucky to get 3 or 4 questions answered.
But the thing is, it's like, what's so interesting is you and I, when we were discussing, you know, this interview and how you're structured, the structure was, you gave me very little information, and I asked very little information. We didn't want to have it. We knew it was in our head that it has to be natural. I'll tell you, I'm going to ask you, what's your top three pet peeves in interviewing somebody? What are the things that really do your head in?
People that don't know what they're talking about. I think that's the first. They try to act like that they do. See, he's turning the this on me, and this is about Henry, right?
But, it's about us, brother. It's about us.
But I think the number one is talking to people that have no clue what they're talking about. And you challenge them, you quiz them on things, and you ask them and try to speak their language, right? And they don't understand a freaking thing that you're saying. They're like,
that's number one.
Yeah, okay. And number two, people that don't like Mexican food. I don't get that. I love Mexican food.
Really? You can't interview somebody that doesn't eat. I love Mexican food. Thank God.
I put that out just to be funny. A pet peeve are people who abuse animals. I don't like that at all. And the third pet peeve that I have as far as interviews is when I'm talking to somebody, and no matter what that it is, they try to play a blame game and trying to blame other people for either failure. They try to blame other people and putting naming other folks and saying, you know what, this is, you know, anyway, I don't like that either. I just don't. What about you?
Well, before we go to me, just for a question, just to clarify something, because I'm really interested. How do you know when you're interviewing somebody that they don't know what they're talking about?
You can tell it by the way that the interview is going, Henry.
South.
I yeah, exactly. Like bingo. And although you do live south of the equator, you're not all the way south, right? But he is too funny, folks. But I can feel it. I mean, I've done interviews for well over 30 years in media, and I've talked to some of the best of them. I've talked to some of the worst of them. And you just get that feeling.
You know, and the second thing, because, you know, it's interesting what you're saying, and I'd love to respond to your pet peeves before I tell you mine, because we're going to share, is animal cruelty. And actually, on that for a moment, I have a really, really dear friend who lives in New York City. I have many after 15 years who lives in New York City. I have one who's got an amazing, amazing movement called loveyourself.com, the Love Yourself Project, and another one, Animal Fair. And Wendy Diamond is the epitome of, you know, animal welfare and negating cruelty. And I said to her one day, Wendy, you're really well known for it. You have this whole movement. But why? She said, honey, I'm going to tell you something. I'm like, okay, honey, tell me something. She said, you know what? If somebody's cruel to animals, they're going to be cruel to human beings.
Right.
So just on that, to share with you. And number three, the blame game. God, that's boring. So bloody boring. Who cares? You know, it's like, accept your responsibility. So just on that, for me, what are the three pet peeves in being interviewed? First of all, somebody that wants to send me 100 questions. It's like, and they say, come on, let's rehearse. I said, I don't want to rehearse. And they get so flummoxed by it. And I'm like, listen. And they said, but this way we know where you're coming from. I'm like, listen, the whole idea of an interview is you will know how I'm coming. So that's number one. Number two, I think the thing is not knowing how to draw something out of you.
Yeah.
You are the expert, my friend, at what we call squeeze and juice. You know how to squeeze and juice like I've never met anybody in my life. And number three is just, you know, if there's got, like, you're alive, you're kicking, you know, your energy brings on energy. So I think, and it's far and few between, but sometimes it's like, and now I am going to talk about the grass growing underneath my feet. Yes. So I think we're saying the same thing, you know, and that's interesting to hear from you, because I've never asked an interviewer that.
I feel now that I'm in the psychiatric chair.
Listen, brother, isn't it great? And it's free.
Yeah. But, you know, I tell you what, Henry, it is not that often that two people, when they meet up, and even in interviews where it's like two spirits collide or two ideas, they collide, and it becomes a fantastic interview. You know, I interviewed one of the worst interviews. One of the worst interviews I think that I ever did was with someone, and to this day I am appalled at this, but I'm not going to say who it was, there was a young woman that came on the show, and she said, I'm Elvis Presley's estranged daughter. And I was like, oh, okay. And back in the day, we quizzed her on it. And when we would be bringing up very interesting points of view or points of interest, her way out of the moment was, I don't know, I just feel like I'm at home. That's pretty much what she said. She was at home. Have you contacted Graceland? Have you done this? Did you that just wasn't good. And I was like, oh God. But I think that has to be in the top two worst interviews that I've ever done.
But here's the interesting point, Robert. The interesting point there is that you were prepared to take the risk, because if you were to pre-rehearse that, it would be an absolute pre-rehearsed interview. It would never come across with all the interviews you've done. So I want to ask you this question, and be honest with me, before any, because look, I could have turned out to be a dud. You never know. I mean, yes, we've spoken, but I might have been having a good speaking day that day. Yeah. And maybe this morning I would be completely frozen up, or I'm not good. So be honest with me. I wonder what the answer is. He's bracing himself for the question. What is it? You must get a bit nervous before your interviews. You must get a bit like, what happens if this doesn't turn out the way I had hoped it to turn out? You must.
To some degree, I do. But to some, I don't. Mostly, I think I would say I don't, because I let interviews go, and I want them as unscripted as possible, because yeah. I want to get the most out of people. You use the squeeze effect, right? I want to get the most out of people.
Juice and squeeze.
That's it. But you know, I want to lead people into a question and be able to get a good, reasonable response back. And but I worry at times about some of the guests as to what that they would say. I do bring people into, I mean, if I've got a great question, I'll bring people up to the edge and say, okay, here's the edge, here's the cliff. Do you want to take the leap of faith, I guess, to answer the question, and to push forward, and who knows? I mean, I look at it like it's a picture. You can't just look at a picture as a whole image. You've got to look at each individual corner of that picture to see it.
That's true, too. That's true, too.
And it's like your life.
So there's got to be good bits and bad bits, too, right?
Yeah, well, exactly. Henry, it's identical to your life. People, they have to look at the corners of your life to be able to understand you.
That's right.
Because, you know, the different corners of people's lives, this is sort of spiritualistic, maybe. Maybe you could use that. But, you could look at the whole image and not understand a freaking thing about it until you take it bit by bit.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with you. And I think that, you know, anybody that tries to put out there that everything's rosy is obviously trying to hide something. And there's parts of my life that are definitely very unrosy. And I embrace that. I think the difference is I have no problem embracing that.
Yeah.
And the one piece of advice, maybe as we go into the next part of this next hour, is that I think that the one thing I would advise anybody is that it's so much healthier to embrace the things that are positive and to be honest about those things as much as the things that have been negative. There's nothing to hide. Transparency is 2025. It's the future. People want real. And you know what's so beautiful? There's lots of bad things about technology, but goodness knows, You're trending, we're trending, you're holistic, we're holistic. You know, it doesn't matter whether you live in Seattle or if you live in San Francisco or if you live in Sydney or Melbourne or Manhattan or wherever you live, we're all influenced by the same things. And so therefore, these trends that I'm talking about, embracing honesty, reality, it has to be the future because, you know, the fake news or not fake news, it's so boring. It's getting to be so boring now. We're all yawning there going, let's just cut out the rubbish and just be real. So yes, I've had some great highs. I've had some great lows. And I think particularly as we get towards the end of this, I'd like to talk about there are a lot of people left on the street when it comes to homeless, but no one really talks about people left on the shelf, that is 50 plus. So we'll get to that later on.
Well, Henry, you bring up the issue of homelessness. And, you know, I will say this much, and I don't talk about it much at all. But at one time in my life, and when I was down in my career, when I was tossed spiritually, when I was torn mentally, I found myself, of all places, literally in the belly of the beast. Because I moved to New York City knowing nobody. And literally, and at night, I would be sleeping in Grand Central Station. I was there. I was homeless. I had absolutely nothing. I felt that nobody was there to lift me up. Nobody was there to love me and to try to heal my wounds. Until one day, one man that I will never forget him. He stepped up to the plate. He lived in the city. And he said, you know what? Come with me. You're going home with me. Take a shower. Wow. Get cleaned up. We're going to go have dinner. And we did. And I will never forget Matty for his help, for his love, for his and for what he did. You know, Henry, it was a matter of faith and confidence on his part that what he was doing was the right thing. And you know what? If it wasn't for him, I would have died in the streets of New York.
You would have. 100% you would have. No doubt about it.
And
no doubt about it.
Today, I could not fathom. We look at homelessness. Yeah, let's look. Seattle has a huge homeless crisis. It is of national proportions. It is horrendous. New York does. Dallas does. Houston does. London does. Sydney, Australia, they have a problem with homelessness. So what do you do? Okay, now let's look at this. Because, Henry, we can look at and address homeless people that are without a home. They're without a job. They're without any kind of hope and any kind of dream. And then you can look at those people that are homeless. They have a home. But spiritually, where they live and what they thrive for, their thirst, their hunger in life, that is what is destitute. Ouch, Henry. Did you get what I just said?
Mate, you get what you said? I'm feeling it through every bloody cell in my body, and I'd like to respond thusly in two ways.
Please.
Number one, my estimation of you has gone through the ceiling, and I'll tell you why. Because there's no such thing as everything being rosy. And the fact that you're sharing this with your listeners and with me is not because you are billboarding to make yourself grander, but to share vulnerability. And that we are all on that line. You are a man amongst men. I want to tell you that. That's it's something that will stay with me. This interview will stay with me. Your comment will stay with me. Because what you're doing is you're opening up a can of worms. And you're not saying, well, you're not a victim. What you're saying is this can happen to anybody. And we're going to get back to this topic.
Yes.
Number two, just to fast forward my life so this makes, because we can skip a bit. And so because this is relevant to you and me, and I told you, I want this interview not just to be relevant to me. So now we're really getting to the nitty gritty. Okay,
right on.
Now we're really getting to some great stuff. Now I've got to learn. I want to learn. And so all I can say is, if we fast forward, the background that I have is a Holocaust. I had a law degree. I was the worst student in the school. I came out at the age of 35. I said to my parents, I am not going to give you children. I'm going to go to America. I'm going to get a TV show. I got on TV in America from 2003 to 2005, right across the Star Network called the Star Style Court. I then jumped over. My sister still has at a place called Kleinfeld, which is Say Yes to the Dress. We did some amazing stuff at Kleinfeld. She's still there. We're highly respected designers in New York City called Henry Roth and Michelle Roth. I then jumped over back to Australia, where I was I auditioned for the Mentor and Project Runway Australia. I did that. Then my parents' business has been going on for 60 years. Couldn't compete with internet, so the Australian side, we stopped. And that's where I saw the other side of people, because although I elected, I had a My Key, which is like a transport card to live in Melbourne, or a green card, and I chose the Melbourne My Key. I came down to live in Melbourne, and I saw the other side of people. And we're going to talk about being left on the side, or being left on the street, emotionally, whatever it is. I don't even want to get into details, but I was told things like, I've got no substance, and I use too many hashtags. Like, now, when you're down, that's like a kick in the teeth.
Yeah.
But I can only say I've had some amazing people that have helped me. And now I'm actually involved. So I did a lot of TV up to the point where I thought to myself, enough TV, I was on Biggest Loser. You know, all the American shows you've got, I was on the Australian version of it.
Oh, my.
Okay? Yeah, exactly. Oh, my, indeed.
Did you ever do a Big Brother?
Do I look like I've got a six-pack here, brother? No. There's come no on. Six-pack here. come on. But the most important thing is, my whole take on any time I did reality TV was actually not putting people down. Yeah. And in one of the reality shows, they said, you've got to be a bitch. And I'm like, I'm not going to bitch anything. And so I handed my part on to somebody else. But the most important thing is that after all of this, I've come to be involved with social enterprise branding, which is, the running of, in America, you understand it. So now that's where we fast forward. It's been a struggle. I'm starting to get on my feet. I've been to the unemployment office, and I went on the Today Show Australia. Please note, Today Show at Australia. And I came out of this social security closet at the time. And I said, I am proud to say that I have paid a lot of taxes, and it helped me. It helped me sort of come to terms with who I am. So now we're going to get, now we're coming together, you and I. So that's been a little bit of a quick bracey. I've done some amazing TV. I've worked with Joan Rivers, who's unbelievable. I've been on Good Morning America with Charlie Gibson. We've been on The View. We had this whole series called Gold at the Bottom of Your Closet with Whoopi Goldberg, you name it. Diane Sawyer, the whole lot. Amazing, amazing people. By the way, all those people worked their bloody butts off to the last second. They're unbelievable. All the characters on Good Morning America. This is Good Morning America. Anyway. So to get to where we are now, there is a lot of vulnerability out there. My question to you is, that one shower gave you confidence, but it didn't get you off the streets completely. What happened then? So just to share with you, we've all been down, we've all been up. So what happened to you then in New York City? Over to you, Mr. Robert.
Oh, wow. You laid a lot out. But
because I want to catch up with you. I want to now speak with you, person to person.
After the shower at Maddie's house, had dinner with him, he then decided, he said, why don't you just move in with me? Yep. And I was like, okay, thank you, Maddie. A lovely invitation, lovely thing. And I did. And Maddie and
I. Hold on, one second. It's my mother on the phone. Mom, I'm on radio. Remember I told you? Mom.
All right, he's talking to his mother.
I'm on radio. Remember I told you?
Yeah, I know. Yes.
Well, go onto my Facebook and you'll watch it, and I'll speak to you afterwards. Okay. Okay. What? Sorry.
Love from near
Oh, my father's okay. Singing happy birthday in Yiddish. Guys, I'm an American syndicate. Everybody's listening to you singing. Go onto my Facebook and listen to me, and I'll call you after I've spoken to Robert.
That's hilarious.
Okay, now that's Jewish parents for you, right?
Yeah, say hello, right. Robert.
He's saying hello. Go onto my Facebook, you can hear me. I'm sorry, but I am speaking to Robert. He called me first. I'll speak to you later. Bye. Bye, bye.
That is too funny. So,
I had to tell, I said, now listen, guys, I know it's my birthday today. Can you do me one favor? Call me after 10 o'clock. Is it a bit? No, they're Jewish parents. They're going to call whenever they want. And they said to you, tell Robert we love him.
Oh, well, hello back. And happy birthday, by the way.
Thank you very much. 58, and I'm bloody proud of it, mate.
58. Oh, my. You know what? I asked Siri on the phone. I asked her, I said, hey, Siri, how old am I? And she says, you're 50 blank, but you don't look like a day or over 29. And I'm like, oh, isn't that just sweet?
Yeah, but it's your spirit, we all know that. So we're going to go back to you.
Yeah,
let's. You said, okay, take a shower.
Yeah, let's go back to the shower. I can't believe I just said that. So we're going to go back to the shower. But Maddie, he asked me later that day or the day after, I can't remember, if I wanted to move in with him. And yeah. I did. And I started getting my life back on track from the kindness and the generosity of this man and his landlord, Alfie, loved her to death. She and her husband, they owned a bakery, a chain of bakeries in Queens, New York, New York City itself, and I believe one or two in Brooklyn. And so they were okay, and I fell in love with her. And the funny thing is, she was German. And she had an extremely strong German accent, and she had never had, now we're going to go back to chicken, she had never had fried chicken before. She never heard of it. And wow. And I said, okay, well, let's do a dinner. We'll cook a dinner. And so she invited friends. We invited friends, Maddie's friends. I didn't know anybody except for those two. But suddenly by the end of that dinner, I had friends in the city. And there was Maddie. He was a hair and makeup artist for print and for television. He still does it today. Very successful, and he's done Donald Trump's hair too. I would imagine Tina Fey's hair from SNL. I mean, I don't know, but. You know, but that's what he's done. And for me though, I continued my quest in media, because that has always been a passion of mine. And then I moved from New York City back to LA and lived there for a good while, worked in the LA market before moving to San Francisco and ultimately to Seattle 24 years ago.
You know, it's so humbling because the work I do now, and you know, this really morphs into your particular scenario that you had then. And first of all, obviously, how proud you are. Is Matty still alive?
Yeah, very much alive.
Can we give him a hand of applause, please? because the thing is, that's humanity. And so
yeah.
I think you reach a time in your life and an age in your life, and you think to yourself, obviously, we ask ourselves, why were we born on this planet? What is life all about? What was I put on this planet for? And what's my responsibility? So when we talked about the Holocaust, it dovetails into, I believe, this. I'm actually working at the moment for this amazing as social enterprise. And I do believe it'll hit America. And it's called You Foodie. And by the way, if you don't mind, at the end of this interview, I'd just like to remind people of some of the amazing people that I'd like to put them in contact with to broaden their worlds. But they're called You Foodie, UFOODI.com. See, in Australia, we've become American. We've cut out the AU. Those clever people that understand. They're not AU. And you're like, what?
Yeah, they do. I don't know what's up with that. We'll have to get Sasha. I mean, I love Sasha. I think that they were great. Yeah, but when they said it would be like the RobertChristianShow.com.au, the way that they said it was hilarious.
Don't tell me. So anyway, so now this is, so these people, and I'm very proud to be working in conjunction with them, there's a lot of statistics about food. So we're talking about poverty, we're talking about homelessness, and eventually I do want to get to the 50 plus problem in a moment, but this is actually people on the street we're talking about. And you know what, I all those people watching and listening us today, and hello to everybody in the world, we're not really that far from that fine line. And the interesting thing with this is, did you know that we produce enough food on this planet to feed everybody? And I think there's some horrendous figure of something like 1.6 billion people will go to sleep tonight not having enough food and being hungry. So this app is about circumventing food waste at the restaurant cycle before it becomes waste, and also providing a choice through a pre-order app. So I'm involved with that. And so I think to myself, what does this mean? And I think this, if every single human being took responsibility and paid forward, we would not be in the situation we're in, number one. Number two, a reminder as a Jewish citizen on this planet that we all own part of this planet, and no one has, you know, there's all these fighting about that's your land and my land. First of all, what I think Jewish people want is we want a recognition that we have the right to exist in our land.
Yes.
Because that's really important, that the Palestinians have the right to their homeland. But not if they want to wipe us off the planet. If they want to wipe us off the planet, I'm really afraid, and it goes back to the Holocaust, and I don't want to cause a big political thing here, we're not prepared to sacrifice another 6 million people. Simply not.
Right.
And the tragedy of that situation, and I don't want to get too political, is that putting women and children in the firing line is going to have tremendous fatalities. We cry in our hearts. Do we want fences and walls which we came out of during the Holocaust? Think about it, Robert. It's such a horrible image for us. But the bottom line is this. So we must respect. We must move forward as human beings. Adopt a human being. Like, look at Matty. You're a young human being.
Yes.
Everybody adapt somebody and not put them down, as my parents have taught me, and bring them up. Because after all, my mother wrote this book that I told you about, The Right Time to Speak, not as a downer, but the lessons learned. And one of the number one lessons that book teaches you is this. We are all human beings. We all have the right to mutual respect, and hatred won't win. And especially in the context of today, anyone whipping up hatred, just move aside. Not on our time. Not relevant. And I think the one pet peeve I have, and I'll be quiet here for a moment, is this. It's when people, like I have, my Facebook is very open, I talk about global affairs, but when anybody starts talking in negative language, supporting what I believe, I'm like, excuse me, and I take it off Facebook and I say, look, I'm really sorry. We don't have language like that for anybody. Mm. Everybody has to have the right language. Don't use those terms on my Facebook, because if you do, I'm afraid you and I are not going to become friends anymore. And I think that people realize after a while they get so caught up in this, you know, it's an example of what they think that they can speak like. And I think you and I are here to say, if you haven't got something too nice to say, don't say it at all.
That's exactly right. And you know, Henry, I think I know that we can learn an awful lot from each other as human beings, no matter who that you are, no matter where that you go or what you've experienced, if we would but listen with our ears and take it into our heart.
I agree. You see, the thing is, the world is so amazing in one regard. There can be so much love brought through mediums like this, but there also can be so much hell. And I want to say to you, you know, to me, I think the darkest moments of my life were 2017, when ISIS was at its peak, because the horrendousness, you know. So I spoke in front of the Sydney Jewish Museum. My mother was, you know, they were commending, she'd just come back from Poland. And the thing is, it's like that cruelty that has been bestowed upon the Yahrzeit women, the authorized rape camps. Then I talked about the people in North Korea. Then I talked about the killing fields. So you know what my parents told me about the Holocaust? They said like this, they should actually become an international day, Holocaust Day. Not just Jews, not just gays, not just gypsies, not just North Koreans, but anyone. And then I think we would see that. Can you imagine if all those people, got together internationally on one day, Robert. Can you imagine the power of that?
Well, you know what, Henry, you said, let me go back, that you were 35 when you came out to your family. For me, I was, I believe, 30. And, you know, I was disowned by all but one of my sisters. Wow. And come to find out 24 years later, my mother has come to great terms with it. She gets it. She understands it. She has accepted my partner. She, my other sisters, have in turn met my partner, and all is well. My biological father, however, I've not seen him in well over 30 years. And so I'm not missing much there. But, you know, I think that it is very sad, though, Henry, that when people, they try to characterize people and put them all in a box. And if people don't fit into this mold, they are tossed away. They're thrown away and they're given up on. And when it comes to Henry Roth, there's one person in his life that never threw him away and understood his deepest and darkest secrets always. And that was himself.
Yeah, no, it's really true. I mean, on the being disowned, that's what I was petrified about. And I had various forces in my family, some saying, do it, some saying, don't do it. I understand what you're talking about. And when it comes to deepest and darkest, I think the best for me is yet to come. I've had some amazing highs with regard to the media. And so there's an adrenaline. You understand more than anybody what it means to have an adrenaline rush when we do something like this. I mean, I woke up this morning and it's a natural thing for me. I used to wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, have makeup put on, the music was blaring. I used to dance around in my underwear with the makeup people, and across the road, which is where I am living now, we used to take Project Runway. Now, how do you come down from that? How do you come down from 37 years of being a radio, syndicated radio host? It's very, very tough. So the way I look at it is, my best days are yet to come. The platforms that I thought I would be able to use have been disappointed that they are not available. And I'm really, sometimes I'm good with it, and some days it destroys me when I think about that should have been the platform for me to carry on because I'm not having children, all that sort of stuff. But I have to accept it. Sometimes I know I'm extremely ungracious. Sometimes I know I'm really difficult and I can be a real a-hole. I can be really horrible about it because I am an eccentric character and I am a character that's fueled by adrenaline. I am. I mean, look at my backdrop. There's Astro Boy, there's a globe, there's like, you know, people think that I should be like, you know, if you see my drawers, there's cement. I live like a New Yorker. But the truth of the matter is, I have to believe, and I haven't found it yet, and that's what I want to dovetail into. You know, we talk about the deep and darker secrets, and a good little ploy, because then you open up the wounds, Mr. Robert. You are not an international interviewer for nothing, young man. But what I want to say is this, and that is that the bottom line being that the best has yet to come. When I think about that the best is not yet has gone, I can't live with it. I can't console with it. And so it comes to the 50 plus. And it's another movement that I'm, you know, championing. And that is basically around the world, I have people who are my friends, whether it's in London, whether it's in China, in Hong Kong, in Sydney, in Melbourne, in New York, doesn't matter where. They get to that age of 50 and all of a sudden they're not wanted anymore. They're not needed anymore. They're put on the shelf. They're like, they do secondhand, third-hand things. And I think it's a real major issue. And I think it's causing a lot of dysfunction and it's causing a lot of issues on the planet. And that's why I believe going into social enterprise, starting businesses that give back, you have more of a chance of competing on that level in the open marketplace.
You know, I people have asked me, Henry, when am I going to retire and completely get out of media? And the funny thing is, I'll tell people, you know, I don't know. What am I going to do after retirement? I don't know. But I would tell people the day that I retire, and I've said this for a long time, you'll think it's funny maybe, but I would tell them I am going to, the day I retire is the day that I grab my microphone and drag it behind me and walk off into the sunset.
And continue talking. You're not going to retire. You're going to continue talking. And you're not retiring. You're not retiring. It's in you. Come on. How many years have you been doing it? It's in your blood.
You know, I a dear friend, love him to death. He is a celebrity auctioneer, and from Storage Wars, L.A., a big show on the A&E network here in the United States. But Dan,
and in Australia.
Yeah, oh, it's in Australia. Oh, geez, I ought to tell
everything's
Dan.
Everything's in everybody's Australia, man.
But Dan, I told him, I said, look, Dan, here's the deal. And I told him, I think it was the last show, I said, Dan, here's the deal. Because I needed a new microphone system for this. And I said, look, it's either I'm going to get a new microphone replacement, or I'm just going to have to retire. Because I'm getting too over this, and he, so what should I do, Dan? What should I do? And he looked at the camera, and he pointed his finger, and he said, "Get your microphone."
Oh no, you can't. Yeah, exactly. You're never going to retire on that. And talking about retirement, what's your take and your experience on people 50 plus? What's your take on that?
I think, you know, it's odd that you say that, because a dear friend of mine. And one of the syndicates posted on his personal page, he posted a question about this, about people that are 50 years old, and he is so upset, because in the LGBTQ community, once that you get past 29, they're ready to throw the shovel at you. When you're 50, and you go into a bar, they're like, "Why do I want to dance with a grandpa for?" You know, and here you are, you want to hang out with young people, good-looking, energetic people, feel the energy, get into this, and have a great time. But some of these younger generation people, they look at you and they're like, "Oh my God, what rock did you crawl out from under?" What are you doing here? Shouldn't you be in a nursing home?
Do you take what they think about you to heart?
You know what? To some degree, I must admit, Henry, I do. I am one to wear my feelings on my shoulder until the wrong is made right. Because of anybody that knows me, they will know two things: that I will always stand up for what the right of it is and what the fair of it is. I don't care who is right or who is wrong. It's not about that. It's the matter of principle. So in my principle, I need to own an apartment complex and just rent it out to really cute guys.
Okay, now we're talking about Fantasy Island. We also have that on Australian TV.
Yeah, well, okay.
Well, and then tell them they have to say, because the rent's free, yeah, then they have to say that you're cute or something, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. Look, I'm going to be honest with you when it comes to that scenario, right? So, first of all, I would say to you, I understand. I would also say to you, obviously, I'm 58 today, so obviously there could be times when people would say, where did you crawl from or not crawl from? I can't live without music and dancing. I actually learned my best hip-hop moves, and let me tell you, I don't, you know, stand on top of my head and do that business. But I have to tell you, I call them the millennials, I call the youth of Australia. Now, as a youth of Australia, try and copy me while I'm dancing, and I don't care what they think about, because I know I do a double flip and they can't catch up with me. So now, I'm oblivious to you.
Who is your favorite musical artist?
You know, I'm going to tell you right now, I think what's capturing my imagination, because this is America. That track is unbelievable. You know which track I'm talking about? This is America. You must. And anyone listening to this, it is a scathing look at America today, but in a beautiful way. And it gives you a lot of hope because it's really honest and real. But, you know, I actually listen to a lot of Israeli music as well. And my actual number one international favorite at the moment is Netta, because I also understand she also has a repertoire, some Hebrew, some English. And from the Eurovision, you know, to take I'm Not Your Toy and throw it into the Me Too movement and make it an international song where, regardless of prejudice or not prejudice, she spoke to everybody. To me, she's a hero, a global hero at the moment. And so, although she's not exactly hip hop, but my God, she's done you know, covers of all different kind of artists. So you should get onto that. Also, definitely get onto This Is America. What about you?
Okay. I mean, I do enjoy Cher. I do. I don't imitate Cher, by the way, but I do like
her. Come on, can you do a bit of it? I'll tell you what, let's do a bet here right now between Seattle and Melbourne. You do one and I'll do one. Let's see who's better.
A Cher imitation.
Come on.
I don't.
What are you going to lose?
I don't have the wig. I don't have the.
You don't have to have the wig. I mean, you have to have the tune. You got the tune.
The tune. Oh, my God. You know, I've never, ever, ever.
I've never done
shame
that.
On
never
you. Done shame on you, Henry, for being the first one in 30 years that said, let's pop out a tune. Let's imitate Cher.
Okay, what tune do you want to pop out? Hold on.
You know, I don't know.
My headphones just went.
But I should do I like Cher. If I could turn back time. But I do like Cher.
Do turn back time. Come on.
But I don't really do a lot of music, though. That's the thing about it. My partner does. But he likes some of the disco stuff, you know. I mean, that was a fun age in music. But this rap stuff that they've got going on today, Henry.
I love the rap stuff. In actual fact, although you can't see it now, on my left is a satellite radio thingy. And I actually get 97.1 hip-hop and R&B live direct from New York City. When I wake up in the morning, I put that on. And so I'm really in touch with them. To be honest with you, I don't always know what the artists are. They go, yo, 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 this is 97.1 FM. Here we are in New York City. What's up, man?
Yeah.
And I love it. Also, another person I want to direct people to, his name is DJ Unknown NYC. And when I was living in New York City, I was introduced to his music, the hip-hop stuff, and I basically ended up at points being the only white Jewish boy in the whole club. And I used to go up there in the DJ booth, and do you know what? The reception I got as an Aussie white gay Jewish boy amongst all these amazing guys, I think I got, you know, I think as an Australian you get like a special dispensation of what some sort, which you shouldn't, was actually mind-blowing. And I learned a lot about hip-hop, and at one point I actually understood what they were saying.
Yeah.
Like, that's how good I was with it. But I think that, I don't know, I think my mother must have listened to music when she was having me, or, you know, gestating me. And I can't do without music. But on that 50-plus and gay and being left on the, what's that song? Dancing on My Own. Dancing on My Own is a tune that talks about somebody that's left dancing alone. And I think the thing is, yes, there are people that might think that way, but then who are they?
Yeah.
Like, where are they coming from? I don't care that they think that I'm old or young or hip or not. I just want to go on the dance floor. I might meet some friends up here in Melbourne. I might not. And, you know, I've never been a big drinker, and I certainly... I'm not going to start becoming an alcoholic at this point, because it's just like no point. And Jews don't drink that much on Shabbat anyway. We're known for it. And just dance, just listen to the music, because in the field that I am in, which is social enterprise and what I do, and I consult with companies, branding, all that sort of stuff, you kind of need to have a heartbeat of what the youth culture is. And that's what I try and do. What about how do you keep a heartbeat on the people that you invite interviewing? Like, because you've really reached out far to Melbourne, Australia, to interview me. How do you find the people that you find to interview?
That's the very odd. I go, there is a website that I use periodically on seeking out for guests. And when I put up a specific theme for a show, an interview for the future, at times the show gets booked out. This one gets booked out 6 months in advance.
You're kidding me?
No, I'm not. And
wow!
But this is the sad thing, Henry. As far as the show and our fans of the show, they all know that this is what's up. But it's a do or die deal, because this show at one time it was Monday through Friday, a 2 hour show Monday through Friday, and then it was cut back because of a lack of funding to 2 days per week, and then the show was still not getting the funding just to stay live on the air to help to cover the expenses of the hardware, the software, just to keep going. And now here we are down to 1 day a week. And but I do a 15-minute podcast on Thursdays for syndicate radio stations, which is a way, way different format than what this is.
But can I ask you this? Can't you do like a, what do they call them? Like a radiothon, where you open up the thing and in the 2 hours you do a thing where it's a radiothon. Have you tried that?
You know, I have. The last one that we actually did, Henry, it had very little of anything to do with this show at all. But I was on the air for 9 hours, something about that, nonstop, raising funds for a man that needed a new wheelchair.
Right.
And his insurance would not cover the cost of it. And we're looking at $4,000+.
And how much did you raise?
We raised just over $5,000.
So you got your goal?
We met it, yes. And after, I had two or three other celebrity websites, their live streams that they put up, that were covering it. And, I would see their chat rooms. And one guy, he said, "When is this guy ever going to shut up?" He's been at it for 9 hours and he's still going strong. When is he going to shut up? And it dawned on me, I will shut up when the need is met.
That's right. So can't you then transfer that concept over to your show? Can't you do a 9-hour wall-to-wall... I'll come on with you.
You know, Henry, I would so do it, but it's easier for me to raise money to help other folks with either their careers, with what they need going on, with their medical need, with their need for food, et cetera, et cetera, than it is for me to say, "Hey, guys, we need to raise $500 just to stay live. Just to be able to meet the need." I mean, it's easier for me to do it for others, but when it comes to meeting the need of the show, no, it's not easy.
Well, that makes sense though. But because we become friends, it's official, right?
Yeah.
Whether you like it or you don't like it, I think that we should. I've got a few ideas for you because I'm an ideas man. But it does make sense. It probably has to be somebody other than you. How do you gauge how many people are listening to us right now? How do you gauge what the response has been?
I can look. Folks, this is sort of off the cuff. I have two chat rooms that are open right now. Oh, hello, Sharon. I don't want to ignore you. Sharon is over on Facebook. Then, of course, there's the YouTube, but the television syndicate network that we're on, I have no idea. I talked to the owner before, and we would get probably somewhere about $4 million or so a year or so that would watch the content on a weekly basis, though. I would probably say
that's good.
150,000, perhaps. I really don't know, to be honest with you,
brother. That's the size of an average city in Australia. you're doing really, really well.
I mean,
I
think that the show it could be better. I think so. But in order to get from point A to point B and where we need to go, you know, it is going to take absolute outreach. It is going to take a lot of advertising. It is going to take people to get them off of their backside to say, you know what, I will make this contact and that contact, this other. I've had people say, why aren't you on satellite radio? Well, we're not on there because they haven't contacted us, at least not yet. And I don't know anybody in that industry.
Well, there's ways around it. The positive thing is this, right? If I was talking to somebody that didn't have the skills, we'd have a problem there.
Yeah.
The other thing is, when we look about the positives, about 4 million people a year is about a quarter of the population of Australia.
Oh,
so you're doing really, really well there. And third of all, what you are doing, don't forget, is you're bringing in fresh wind, fresh ideas. And it's not the total number, it's actually the hearts that you're reaching.
That's
and
right.
You stretched over the pond, if you like. I'm going to ask you the top three things that you've gained from this 2-hour interview, and I'm going to respond back to you. But first over to you. What do you think are the top three things that are your takeaways today?
Okay, let's make it 6, 7, 8. Let's make it about a minute and a half total. The three things that I've taken away, that there is hope for humanity. We just have to look for it. Second, we can overcome the adversities of the past and move on and become a bright and a fabulous light for the world to see today, not reflecting on the past. And thirdly, to reach out. There's nothing wrong with the heart that reaches out to the populace, no matter who they are or where they are. Go.
For me, number one, everyone is on a very fine line. And there's no shame in talking about the things that are light and dark. Otherwise, you become a one-dimensional character which people are bored with. Number two, I humbly believe that we are now all unified in one globe. And that power can be great and it can be not great. And it is our responsibility to keep it great. And number three, the Holocaust and all the transgressions that have happened in genocides need to be turned into one group and looked upon as not just never again, but here and now, what can you do as a human being to perpetrate goodness and to really keep things moving in a positive direction, because the world needs that right now.
You know, I agree. And Henry, I think that the bottom line of all of it is that we as human beings, that we should listen with our heart, because we know the difference between what is right and what is wrong.
That's right.
We know the difference. If we listen, you could read history books all you want. You could go online all you want and find history, find facts.
Yep.
But until you are willing to listen, not hear them, you're going to miss it.
I agree. And if in the last few minutes, if I can have the honor and your permission, I'd just like to put people in contact with a few websites that are not necessarily profit-making. My mother's book, therighttimetospeak.com, my dear friend Wendy Diamond, animalfair.com, my dear friend in New York City, Love Yourself Project, my dear people down here in Australia at youfoodie.com, and to you, Mr. Robert Christian, your website, which is robertchristianshow.com. Ultimately, none of them had any use. And also, finally, the teenageexpo.com.au, which is Sonia and Sasha. So I have to tell you, as I go on to having a cafe latte with my dear friend Kellyanne Evans for my 58th birthday, I have to say, you are a squire, you are a gentleman, and where the hell did you get that hat? Because I want one.
You know, I love that. I love my hat.
I really love that too. Where do you buy it from? Secret.
No, I can tell you off the air. Okay. But I'll tell you. Okay. Hey, but Henry, hang on if you will for me. Don't go too far. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, and it has been a joy. It really has to have Henry Roth tuned in and joining us on today's live show. He has got one amazing story, and I just can't thank him enough for his love, his inspiration. Folks, let us go into this world and inspire somebody. Let's love somebody. Whatever you do, find somebody and love them. We'll see you next time on The Robert Christian Show.